Warning, this stream is rated for mature audiences. Viewer discretion is advised.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the WandaNet, domesticshelters.org theater. My name is Scotty. Let's get some information there. Domesticshelters.org, if you are somebody who can donate a little bit of money or items, all you have to do is go to domesticshelters.org, search for your local domestic violence shelter, and they all have usually like a wish list, items that they need, toiletries, toothpaste, toothbrushes, socks, hats, gloves, any of that stuff. So just check it out, and every little bit helps. Hello, Joe Ho, and anybody else lurking around in the background. Welcome. All right. Tonight, Don Juan, starring John Barrymore, 1926, directed by Alan Crossland, who you probably have never heard of, but he was fairly big back then. It was the first feature-length film to utilize the Vitaphone sound-on-disc sound system with a synchronized musical score and sound effects, even though it still had no spoken dialogue. You'll see, you know, with most typical silent films, it's got the little placards for the most important dialogue that they put up in between the scenes. Inspired by Lord Byron's 1821 epic poem, Don Juan, and what you're going to find out is that, you may have heard some things previously, some idioms or some social, not narratives, what am I thinking of? Just like social terms. If somebody says a guy is a Don Juan, it typically refers to being very popular with the ladies, or more specifically, a lot of women being attracted to that man. You're going to see exactly where that term comes from this movie, because even though it was based on Lord Byron's poem, This was the first movie to actually flesh that out into a sort of a romantic adventure style, and you know, really put it into you know, an action thing where not only was there this love story with Mary Astor as the love interest, main love interest, but the other women that are involved, the other characters that are interacting with Don Juan. So yeah, it'll be fun. And you're also going to see how it also becomes a little bit of a misnomer further on into the film. So without further ado, here we go. Don Juan from 1926.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
So that's the end of part one there. So we started out the movie basically with not Don Juan, but his father, Don Jose. And John Barrymore played both parts, just with, you know, older makeup, a little bit different makeup for the father's role of Don Jose. And as you saw in the beginning, Don Jose, he caught his wife cheating on him and sealed the lover alive in his hiding place inside the castle wall. And then he, you know, confronted her and drove her from the castle. But he's stabbed by his latest mistress after that. And with his dying words, he implores his son, Don Juan, to basically just don't actually give anything of yourself to women that you are involved with. Just take from them, okay? So, Don Juan's character, where he basically becomes this sought-after ladies' man, is extremely influenced by his father basically just telling him with his dying breath, don't fall in love, don't give of yourself to any woman that you're with. So, already, we're in this psychological quandary here, and then it then builds itself up into this storyline where we're looking at multiple love triangles at the same time, and all of them caused by Don Juan, who is just basically doing his best to fuck every single woman that comes across his path that he takes a fancy to, and not giving a shit about any of it. So now, then we jump to 10 years later. Young Don Juan, who is graduating from the University of Pisa, is famous now across the land as a lover and pursued by many women, including the powerful Lucrezia Borgia, who you just saw there at the end of part one, invited him to her ball. You're going to see now in part two how that's going to play out, this love triangle between Lucrezia and Don Juan, and the person that Don Juan is infatuated with, a woman named Adriana. So we're going to take a short commercial break and come back for part two. Stay tuned.
Thank you. Thank you.
All right, so that's the end of part two there. So just to recap, at the end of part one, we left off with Lucrezia Borgia inviting Don Juan to the ball. So then in part two, we started with them at the ball, and you can see that basically Don Juan was, for the most part, respectful of her and her position and her power and her family's power, but he instantly, you know, was following with his eyes Adriana, who was the daughter of the Duke della Farnese, and clearly Lucrezia was just so angered by this that she hatched then that night a plot to basically poison Adriana's father, the Duke della Farnese, and marry her to Count Giano Donati, who was basically one of her henchmen. And therefore, by sealing that marriage, that would leave then Don Juan free for her pursuits. So you see then part of what happened with there is the courtship that had to take place, you know, a public presence in which the Count Giano Donati went to her father to ask for her hand in marriage, even though it was supposed to be arranged and all that. And finally they acquiesced to that simply to try to avoid the pain that was going to come. But now Don Juan is going to try to save Adriana from this fate, and Lucrezia is inviting Don Juan to this wedding in order to, like, basically shove it in his face. Sorry, you can't have Adriana. You're going to be mine. So now what we're going to see coming up in part three is a romantic story notion that was very popular in romantic stories at not only the turn of the century, going back as far as like the 1750s and on into the early 1900s, whereby if you cannot be with your love interest, you know, you've got a young couple that's in love, if you can't be together, it's better to die. And you saw that in like Romeo and Juliet, the star-crossed lovers who fought desperately to try to be together, but they just couldn't make it happen, and therefore it was better to just die instead of being apart. And that type of romantic story notion is playing out now as Don Juan being summoned to this wedding that was going to be shoved in his face. Sorry, you can't marry Adriana. That's what he's going to be considering, along with Adriana, that maybe it's just better to commit suicide than to allow this to happen as Lucrezia wants it to happen. So we're going to take a short commercial break and come back for part three. Stay tuned.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
right, so there you have it. Part three of Don Juan. And just to recap, so Don Juan was summoned to the wedding, and shortly after that, because they made a big show of the, you know, this wedding and Lucrezia shoving it into Don Juan's face that he wasn't going to be able to have Adriana. So then after the so-called wedding, he kills Count Giano Donati in a duel. And because of that, then Lucrezia's people put Don Juan in prison, in the jail cells in the bottom of the castle, the dungeon. And he escapes and grabs Adriana. They are making their escape, and then you saw there at the end, basically, Lucrezia's men, there was eight of them, and he defeated all of them, and then they ride off into the sunset. Happy ending. However, I did want to say, you know, Don Juan was supposed to undergo this transformation. Like, Adriana basically represented pure honesty and love, and by loving her, he was supposed to become a better man. But there's notions, especially in the Italian version, which goes back to some of the operas that were held in Italy going back into the 1700s for Don Giovanni, that he never changed. He was still the same type of person, only now he's won his love and moved on, and they escaped from Lucrezia, but they, you know, he's still the same old cad he was. So this at least kind of cuts that part out of it and leaves it at, they have a happy ending and they just ride off into the sunset. But yeah, there you go. Don Juan from 1926. Many other iterations. I would also recommend, even though it's not necessarily like even in the same vein as this, but check out Don Juan DeMarco from the 90s if you haven't seen that. That, I think, really does a lot of the original storyline justice. And you know, attacks a lot of the psychology behind this, as opposed to this, which, you know, because of the limitations of film at the time, there wasn't a lot put into the psychology, aside from the stuff that you could read, like, on their faces and, you know, see some of the emotions they were trying to portray. That, I think, is a much more... How shall I say, accurate version of the emotions that were supposed to be portrayed by the storyline and the psychology behind it. So just a little side note on that. All right, let's go over to coming attractions on the EBC channel. First of all, this Thursday night, Matrix Reloaded on the Conflux Discord, our DMCA Nope series, where I'm basically showing movies that Twitch would probably give me a content strike for. So we're not going to do them here. We're doing them on the Conflux. It's just a basic, you know, movie watch party stuff that wouldn't fly here on Twitch. So we're going to continue our Matrix series with the second movie, Reloaded. Then public domain movie night a week from tonight, Attack of the Giant Leeches, The Great Love Story from, Let me check on that, because I think it's 59, but I'm not positive. Yes, 1959, Attack of the Giant Leeches, and absolutely awful creature feature, and hopefully there will be many more of those on EBC. Then that same night, that's Monday, February 21st at 7 p.m., at 9 p.m., we switch over to the Conflux for the third movie in the Matrix series, Revolutions. Mr. Anderson times 10,000. Yeah, like fighting 10 million of the same guy in the rain and breaking up the concrete because it's shoddy masonry and all that shit. And then finally, our next episode of Arcade, still in the works, still not locked in, but we will have the info for you as soon as possible. Sunday, February 27th is when it looks like it will be. and that is a week from this coming Sunday. That weekend, Saturday or Sunday, we will have it, and should have some information fairly soon here on who the guest will be and the game or games that they are playing. So stay tuned. And that just about wraps it up. All right, let's see if there is someone to raid here. If you have a suggestion, you can put it in there. And I will entertain your suggestion, mayhaps. Let's see here. I've got Alice Bunny Holmes, BMO Kit, Gaming Avengers is on. Doing some more Skyward Sword. Ben absolutely hates that. And he likes to rant all the time about how much he hates it. Rising Feathers, May, Casual Gaming Guy. Pockets on, doing some Animal Crossing. You know what? If there's no objections, we're going to do Joho, because Joho is on with his wife for a special Valentine's show, and they're doing Overcooked 2. So if there's no further objections, Your Honor, we'll go over there and say hello to that asshole. Yes? No? Maybe? Okay. There we go. Thank you all so much. See you Thursday in the Conflux for Matrix Reloaded. And, yeah, something like that. I don't know. It's just constant making shit up as I go along and throwing it up on the screen. And for some reason, you people like it. You must be kind of sadistic. Anyway, see you later. Thanks. Adios. Bye-bye.